Welcome, my name is Harry Seymourbergen from the University of Amsterdam. I'm a gemmorphologist, a classical gemmorphologist, and since 5 years or so I discovered the capabilities of object-based image analysis. My work is highly done also in cooperation with my PhD, Niels Hobbes and Willem Bouten. The outline of the presentation will first give you a motivation of the research, then I show you digital geomorphological maps to those. The main part will focus on the workflow for semi-automated geomorphological mapping. And I have one slide for discussion and of course some concluding remarks. The motivation of geomorphological mapping. Since the 1960s or so, several mapping programs at universities existed. All these systems were different, and of course, at that time we went into the field with air photos, stereoscope, and papers and contour line maps. You read about geology and all kinds of other additional contextual information if you want. And from that you draw preliminary map, and with that concept map you went into the field. That was the core of the mapping program, and in the field you corrected and extended the mapping, took some samples maybe for material, quality tests, etc. And from that with a legend you came to the right. Draw in your desk the final geomorphological map. That took a long time, and the product was a paper map. Of course, the challenge is, since 5 to 10 years now, to automate this process, to be more objective, reproducible, and well, digital terrain models are highly suitable for this challenge. It also means that the process can be repeated over time, to detect changes, and perhaps also you can quantify geomorphological change, in particular from two changes and volumetric measures. Two types of geomorphological maps exist. In fact, the classical map you see on the left hand side, that is a symbol based map over here. Of course, you cannot do a lot of analysis from that, so you have to digitize that in a geodatabase here in ArcGIS. You know the layered structure of all these issues. But the second type of geomorphological map, that is, let's say, related to object-based image analysis. And I'm sure you all recognize all these segments and more levels, knowledge rules that you can use to end up with an automated or semi-automated classification. Well, we designed a workflow for geomorphological change analysis, and for that we used LiDAR data, 1 meter resolution of 2002-2005. It was processed the same way by a TopScan company, and they say the vertical error is between 20 and 30 centimeters. I will come back to that in the discussion, I think. We also made training samples using a new technique of RGB composites. And maybe this is the most important part, the segmentation parameterization. Normally, we do an accuracy assessment after the classification. We developed also a manner to do an accuracy assessment in this stage after the segmentation. Classification rules were also developed based on 50 years of experience of the University of Amsterdam mapping in alpine areas. And I will show you that we extract stratified features in this alpine area. And then you arrive at the classification of 2 years, 2002-2005, and that allows you to, let's say, see the changes that happened and maybe to calculate differences in volume. An additional issue was that in August 2005 there was a prolonged period of rainfall, And issues like this, deep-seated mass movement and rockfall change this case study area remarkably. And some of you might recognize the province of Vorarlberg in Western Austria, where this case study took place. Well, we use land surface parameters in the segmentation, sometimes known as geomorphological signatures or topographical attributes. There are many names for that. And of course, there are many of these, more than 150, I think. But we used slope, which is a key parameter in geomorphological processes, topographical openness, how open is the landscape, and we used it at two radii, 25 meters and 250 meters. You can see here the two openness models. And we used an RGB composite that was prepared by merging these three land surface parameters. And that has the advantage over hill shape, for example, that you are not disturbed by shadows and you can accurately delineate training samples. That is shown here, drawn over the aerial photograph. It's difficult to see, I can see it here. We had training samples and validation samples. And of course, we had also this old geomorphological map of 1996 that I prepared at that time to continue with interpretation. The segmentation error, and I took this from a paper by Anders et al, Segmentation Optimization and Stratified Object-Based Analysis for Semi-Automated Geomorphological Mapping, recently published. The idea is that training samples from this RGB composite can be drawn manually. You can check it with the geomorphological map if available. And then you do segmentations between 1 and 1,000 scale factor, and you compare, let's say, the frequency distributions of slope and topographical openness as frequency matrices with the segmented objects. And of course, there will be a difference. But using segmentation error, you can, let's say, find the lowest segmentation error for each object. Let's say for a rockfall area or a glacial eroded area, these parameters will be different. Now, the classification rules are based on these land surface parameters. You see here that we had glacially eroded bedrock, fluvial incision, alluvial and debris fans, deep-seated mass movement, shallow mass movement, and flow slide deposits. The scale parameters we determined differently from 75, 35, 100, 150, 45 for these specific features. The classification is based on elevation percentile, topographical openness, mean slope, standard of the DTM, the high and low areas, standard deviation of slope and distance to river. If you have a fluvial incision, then of course the distance to a river is important. And you can see here, for example, how two examples of signatures that help separate geomorphological landforms and deposits. It is here given for an alluvial fan and a fluvial incision, and the slope is actually a nice separating factor in this, and by using these diagrams you can easily make these classification rules. These are simplified, but here is more or less shown how it works. The drainage network is here extracted using the D8 method, and here the fluvial incisions are extracted. And of course, after extracting the fluvial incisions, you segment again and you classify again, and you loop until you have a complete geomorphological map. Here is a snapshot of how it works in eCognition. I think I won't go into the detail. My PhD student is far more driven in that than I am. But here, after the fluvial incisions, you see that the glacial eroded bedrock is extracted, the alluvial fan areas, deep-seated mass movement, shallow mass movement, and flow slide deposits, and you have a geomorphological map. It looks nice, of course. You end up with two geomorphological maps, 2002 and 2005, and then, of course, it is GIS, not so difficult to see the change. So hatched, you see the 2005 classifications, and if it remains full color, it remains the same between 2002 and 2005. Of course, you can calculate volumetric changes from two volume changes. Of course, there are funny things. You see, for example, that some of the areas locally is hatched in orange, meaning that there is an improvement in glacially eroded bedrock, which, of course, in this area is not is out of the order, because there is no glaciation at the moment. So you have to know how good are these maps. For that, of course, we did a validation, and we used sample sets again to calculate all kinds of statistics. We followed the method of Congleton and Green, that is normally used in remote sensing. And maybe I take out some issues. Glacially eroded bedrock is confused with deep mass movement. You see that out of a total of 374 pixels, 93 are not well classified. Another issue is that fluvial incisions are confused with flow slide deposits from 222 in total, 70 are confused, mistaken. And, well, maybe hopeful that the overall accuracy is above 80%. But if you look at, let's say, simply the change between the DTM of 2005 and 2002 without the geomorphological classifications, you see here a lot of spickles. I'm suspicious if these are real changes or if there are artifacts from the DEMs. We used here a threshold of minus 1 and 1 meter. So in between this range, we said, okay, it is due to unexpected errors and so on, and noise. And above and below the one and minus one, we expect real change. But we are not sure if this is really working. For some areas, we have field information. For example, here maybe you recognize the circular scar of a landslide that corresponds to the photo that I showed before. But in a lot of areas, we have no real field check. Well, therefore, one of my MSc students is digging more into detail into these issues. And what you see here is a profile taken along a debris flow fan. It shows the elevation difference between the two dates. And, well, if it is on this line, there is hardly change. But these areas here, actually, the change happened. This is near a road, this hotspot of this red area, and people, of course, took out the debris flow material that flowed over the road. But these areas, I think these are, let's say, natural changes in debris flows, where material was removed here and deposited a little bit down on this debris flow. Nice to see is that this RGB composite of these land surface parameters also shows these speckles, if you animate it in GIF like this. And actually, my MSc student found out that this has to do with falsifications due to removal of vegetation from the DMs. So it was not really correctly removed. That brings me to my concluding remarks. The method that we propose is a long workflow. It shows potential for geomorphological change detection and application, for example, in landslide hazards and risk studies, and also maybe in geoconservation mapping, because that is highly linked to geomorphological units. But I think at the moment it's only possible to detect changes in highly dynamic processes like debris flows, landslides, and not, let's say, the low frequency processes like solid flexion or creep, etc. And that would be interesting also. Second remark, the geomorphological change detection method gives information on from two changes, so you know that glacial area could change to a mass movement area, so that hotspots can be detected over time, and also the volumetric information is there. And I think that further developments to improve the method should go back to the initial raw data, the raw point data, optimize the measurements, the filtering and interpolation techniques to reduce vertical errors, and especially in steep terrain, the vegetation gives you larger errors than this 20 or 30 centimeters that I mentioned in the beginning. And of course, it would be nice to have more information about transferability and flexibility of segmentation parameters and classification rules, because geomorphological development in an area can be in a certain time snapshot. I mean, time, geomorphological features will develop, and also the land surface parameters will also change. Thank you very much.